Professor Modak sir, can we start?
Yes, we can start.
Yeah, okay. So good afternoon to all of you. Welcome to Air Quality Management Monthly Lecture Series. This particular program is organized by SEPA Network and Department of Civil Engineering, IIT Madras, in association with Indian International Conference on Air Quality Management. Gopika, go to the next slide. So we started this lecture series in October 2020. This is the ninth lecture. So it is a first of its kind where it serves an important forum for the young researchers, scientists, engineers, educators, practitioners to learn the advancement in various technologies and applications in the area of air quality management. Go to the next slide. So these are all the some of the eminent speakers who gave lectures in the earlier air quality management lecture series. And we are with us today, Professor Prasad Modak. Go to the next slide. You may know Professor Modak is a known personality in the international arena. So Professor Modak holds a BTech in civil engineering and a MTech in environmental science and engineering from Indian Institute of Technology, Bombay. And he got his Doctor of Philosophy in engineering in the area of environmental engineering from Asian Institute of Technology, Bangkok. So Professor Modak was a professor at Center for Environmental Science and Engineering at IIT Bombay. He worked about a decade, and later on he became an adjunct professor at the Center of Technology Alternatives in Rural Areas from 2009 to 2017. He currently executive president of Environmental Management Center, LLP, and director of eConnect Knowledge Foundation. Prasad Modak has worked with almost all key UN multilateral and bilateral developmental institutions in the world. These include World Bank, IFSC, Asian Development Bank, European Investment Bank, UNEP, UNIDO, UNDP, etc. And several intra-governmental organizations such as Asian Productivity Organization are also, taken Professor Modak's guidance. Apart from the government of India, various state governments and are seeking the Dr. Modak's advice in in addressing the various environmental issues, particularly air quality management. So he is also been working with government of Bangladesh, Egypt, Indonesia, Thailand, and Vietnam in advising various environmental issues in those countries. I mean, Professor Modak is always, come out with a very innovative ideas, talks, and share the information, particularly to the younger generations. He is motivating for several of us, and he is, keenly working in creating and sharing the knowledge across the globe. Today, we're going to talk about how do you communicate ambient air quality, challenges, and innovations. And all of us knows that more than three decades, and government of India initiated National Ambient Air Quality Monitoring Program. And as you know that some of the monitoring stations generate a huge data. And this data became so voluminous, particularly sometime many state pollution control board will find it very difficult to look at various data and its usages. So particularly the development in terms of dashboard, particularly the SAFAR has come out with an air quality index dashboard to make use of some of the air quality monitoring informations. And currently, there is a sensors, particularly the LOCA sensors, again, it contributing to a large amount of data and how this data can be make use of it for the public. Particularly, several people, they have their own personal devices to get the information, and sometimes how to communicate this information is very interesting. So given the complexity, multi-source, and fuzziness of the data, communicating air quality is often being a challenge. And Professor Modak he is working in this particular area quite some time, and he has advised in various aspects, come out with an innovative idea how to communicate this a large data into a simple means, which will be very easy to understand the not only the regulator but also the community. So with this brief introduction, I'll be great honor and pleasure to welcome Professor Modak to give the Air Quality Management Monthly Lecture Series. Over to you, Professor Modak. And I also welcome all the participants, audience, and experts working in this area to this monthly lecture. Thank you, Professor Modak. I welcome you to the monthly lecture series.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Professor Shiva. It's a pleasure always to be in your lecture series.
I will close it, sir. Now
am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible. You can share the slides, sir.
Yeah, I'll do that. So just a preamble to what Shiva, you spoke. You know, after I gave you the abstract, it always happens that you rethink what should be the focus of my talk. And of course, I will touch upon communication, but I thought I will put some thoughts a bit about the data science itself, and specifically on the air quality, and then come to the point of communication. I hope that variation is okay it's acceptable to you.
Yes, sure.
So let me now share my screen. And let me know whether you can see it. Is it visible?
Yes, sir, it's visible. Please go ahead.
So I rephrase the title as Analyzing Ambient Air Quality Data for Better Decision Making and Communication. So I'm going to walk you through my presentation. And the audience is, I can see it's very diverse. So maybe you should pardon me if I'm talking something very basic, because I really do not have a background about participants. But I suppose all of you have been working for long, or at least interested in the subject of air quality management. When we talk about air quality management in a perspective of right from goal setting, where we aspire what kind of air quality standards that we want to meet, we make use of the information we hold on today's situation on air quality and emissions responsible, so that we could come up with control strategies supported by regulations. And our concern actually is more on the impact of air quality on human health and ecosystems. So being precautionary, being protective is the prime objective. And then we put under the system overall a public involvement so that people are aware in terms of what kind of goals that we have set, what is the situation analysis on air quality today, what kind of emissions are responsible, and what has been the action taken to manage the air quality and move towards the targets or the goals. So you would realize that monitoring is playing a very important role in terms of telling us where we are today, and also telling us what progress have we made because of the various control actions what we have taken. So our interest is to check compliance with these standards. We are also interested to see the changes over a period of time, so assessing the trends. We also would like to know the relative contribution of various emission sources for the interest of prioritization. Might also like to look at a comparative between air quality as we see in different geographical areas, even within the city. One of our interests is to know or speculate what would happen if we implemented a controlled strategies and there we find usefulness of air quality models, and we often use the monitored data to calibrate and verify these models. We could either use models or the data chain itself to come up with forecasting, and that to be used to issue warnings. And not just the controls, in terms of air pollution emission reduction, but we're also interested how effective have been the policies and regulations. And obviously we want to continue conducting air quality monitoring to communicate the status and the progress on air quality to the public. So the monitoring activity has many dimensions, and I think in more than, many cases, we are limiting the understanding of the use of monitoring mainly to look at compliance and maybe at the most to look at trends over a period of time. Air quality monitoring has significantly evolved over decades. And like we used to always see regulatory agencies, putting manual, say, high volume samplers to measure the criteria pollutants. And as we understood more and more about the particulate matter, we added PM10, PM2.5, PM1. You see their lead taken by the research institutions. And more as we started progressing on our instrumentation capabilities, moving to analyzers and then the sensors, and even going through techniques like the open path, now using also satellite imagery, you see a variety of tools are being used now to assess the air quality. I remember we analyzed the aerosol optical depths in different states of the country pre, during, post lockdowns. And they were very useful. These imageries were very useful to get a spatial understanding about the changes in the optical depths, a kind of a proxy to understand the particulate concentrations. From manual, we moved a lot further and got into automated sensor-based systems, but we didn't stay only outdoors, but we started understanding air quality indoors. That is making also communication not so easy. We don't also many times differentiate between pedestrian exposure air quality here. And we understand more outdoor as ambient. Interest in indoor had just started coming about. So the kinds of technologies that we see over years, right from those high volume samplers, you see them on the top left, to sensor-based networks, what you see in the lamppost of Chicago for monitoring air quality. And you see the SUFA benches where sensors are embedded in the bench. And you have these experiments where in London, where pigeons were used sensors to understand air quality. Of course, those were the days earlier of the mobile instruments, but now you can also move and with a watch on your hand wrists, which not only gives you the air quality, but also your pulse rate, blood pressure, such variables. So humongous data. A lot of metadata also coming in, and different technologies being used to monitor air quality. If you looked at the characteristics of the air quality data, keeping this background, first of all, it's multivariate. The variables are increasing that we want to monitor. The standards are now covering a very large number of air quality parameters. Because now that we have continuous monitoring instruments, we have literally volumes of data, it's a big data. Despite all that, you'll find that many times the data lacks regularity. There is an issue there. A lot of missing data is there. Emissions measurements, the ambient air quality measurements, they cannot be, and obviously they are not always in sync. And the information which when we get from different instruments, continuous analyzers, sensor-based, manual, even at the same location, you find differences. And it gives you sometimes a very fuzzy understanding of what's really the air quality. Actually, we also require not just the air quality. I'm not referring here to the MET or meteorological data, but we also badly need metadata. And this culture of observing metadata is not with us today. We don't really do much on that. But it's a very important practice that we do have understanding of the local situation through the metadata. So you do have now air quality monitoring stations with street videos, which also give you some information about the surroundings, what's been happening when air quality is getting monitored. So we talked about multivariate characteristics, the big data, irregularity, the fuzziness, and you would realize that all this is making our understanding of air quality, its analysis, quite complex. And the data sets for which the entire air quality goal setting has been done, that is on health, agriculture, productivity, that doesn't get recorded or published, and there's a significant lag even if such research work has been done. So while we do hold a lot of digits on air quality to compare with the standards, to understand that are we really protecting public health and agriculture, it's not very easily understood. So that's another challenge that we have to remember. If you look at the process from data collection to communication, it involves, of course, data processing, data cleaning, data analysis, and then communication. The data cleaning, which I have highlighted, it's a major, major issue. And those of you who are involved in actually working on the data files, sitting with the pollution control boards or with the industries, you would find that data and data cleaning takes a lot of sweat. And the analytics, when you apply, because we have several tools, doesn't take that much time. I don't know, you know what I'm suggesting, that sometimes I will ask you questions and please use your chat box to give me a response. Will be interesting for me to see later. And my question to you now, to answer in the chat box, that how many of you have actually worked on the data files which you can download from the websites of CPCB or any other pollution control board or from the industries? I would like to know how many of you have actually accessed the files and looked into the data, what quality that data is. It will be interesting to know. So when we start looking more in detail about the kind of data that we have to process, the missing data component is very, very common. You also find suspect values. You don't know whether to base your communication considering these suspect values. We often call them as outliers. And often, those of you who have worked on the raw data would tell me that you do see instances of repeated values, and there are occasions where you will see inexplicable relationships. So missing data occurrences, which I said are common, tells you about the working of the instrument is very important, because in many cases, payments are made to the vendor in a data service model, depending on how much data is generated and supplied. So when you describe any data set, it's important that you also communicate what is the percentage of that data that's missing. Those which are questionable values, where you feel that this data probably does not belong to that sample and could be, as we use the word, outlier, then it's probably telling us that it's an observation lying at an abnormal distance from the other values in the sample out of the entire population. So when you call them as suspect values, you want to investigate why are they there, which may call for some metadata. It could be sampling analysis errors, depending on the type of instrumentation. Could be cases of power breakdowns. There could well be local source influence, which you can see from the cameras, why you see occasional short-term the high values or low values, which is important for us to know why that particular data point is an outlier. Due to sudden changes in meteorological conditions, you may even see such extreme high and low values. So you need to put a lot of things together to make an opinion about the suspect data. And one of the very simple tests which we do is Dixon's four sigma. We look at mean and boundaries of four sigma, and you then can find if this lies beyond this boundary, then the case could very well be an abnormal case, or the data point could be of suspect. Missing data is important to catch in the time series. When you do this analysis, you can see the spots. If these red spots happen to be coinciding for two pollutants, let's say NOx and PM10 here, it tells you probably there is a power breakdown. A lot of diagnosis one can do looking at the patterns of the missing data. And that's something which we have to live with, because we got to either figure out a way that we don't keep the outliers, or we replace them maybe with an average or a local average or a max or min, depending on the value. Do we interpolate, or do we even use regression models to estimate the missing data? Not something I would recommend, but these are all possibilities. But the worrisome part is the length of continuously missing data, which then has to be discarded. And remember, any inferences that you would draw for a largely missing data set to the public, you need to be honest in saying that there has been 30% occasion of missing data. So this is very important. It's a responsibility of the data analyst to talk about both the missing data as well as the outliers. I said repeated values are very, very common. It can mean a faulty instrument. For the MET data, for example, the anemometer doesn't move to find the same direction for a long time. But then you also see patterns, typically diurnal. And if there are excessive repeated values over a long time, what do we do with them? It becomes as good as missing values. So normally when we process a time series of air quality data, we look at scenarios where you find the value of repeated data is occurring how many times and how regularly. This is also a data characteristic. One can in fact generate a sheet of what to report to communicate to someone who is doing an oversight on the data on ambient air quality. And you would talk about percentage missing values or outliers that you suspected. Any metadata based interpretation of those outliers and repeat values We call this as data labeling, which is important in both further analysis as well as communication. And sometimes you find inexplicable relationships. You find PM 2.5 greater than PM 10. And if you took the ratios between PM 2.5 and PM 10, you start looking at outliers. This is an important point that, you know, you got to look at these situations where obviously there is something wrong. And here you find the outliers telling you that there is something abnormal happening to the particulate concentrations in the air. Many times, simple visualization is effective in communication. So visualization communicates. If you start looking at, these are the plots weekly over each day, Monday, Tuesday onwards. And you see, this is a typical characteristics of a traffic influenced ambient air quality station. And you find Monday to Friday, a very similar patterns and weekends, and the traffic is low, the peaks falling down, but still giving you a similar pattern. You have monthly plots. It can give you a, if I were to plot on this, the dry and the wet days of the month, because this is plotted for particulates, I would get a lot of interpretation from this kind of a monthly plot. This is the diurnal plot, which we saw earlier. You can also make a special weekend plot. So communicating time series, cleverly chosen for weekdays, weekends, seasonally, monthly, they communicate a lot. Since we talked about changes over time, one of our interests is to communicate what's happening to the long-term and trends and the short-term changes and the violations over standards. And I'll talk about a violation index a little later. Very rarely, I have seen regulators in our country estimating long-term trends quantitatively and reporting short-term changes. We'll look at this as we go along. When it comes to detection of long-term trends, of course, because we know pollutants have their variability, and our interest is whether there is a increase or decrease over time, because we are, you know, doing enforcement or taking policy planning measures. We need to therefore understand which direction is the trend and what is its magnitude that can help us to determine whether the trend is statistically significant. So there are so many ways that you can detect air quality trends, both parametric and non-parametric. Many times we use non-parametric tests because they are not so sensitive to distributions as well as outliers. But remember that they are unable to handle seasonal variability, so you have to be careful there. And if you used the non-parametric tests, again, they're pretty robust when it comes to data sensitivity. One technique which I use extensively for air quality data trends is to do the MK test, the Mann-Kendall test. And here we calculate Kendall's statistical measure S, Kendall's correlation coefficient tau, and the Kendall's test P. What it means through an example is we look at, for example, this data from Jan to December for PM 2.5, and then we know that we have 12 observations. Then we follow the MK procedure where we compare each value to the value located to the right and keep moving. So we compute here for this time series of data the PIs and QIs as defined earlier, where we look at number of observations which exceed the value of that Y, that is in this case 280, and go to the right, and QR that do not exceed. And once we get this done in terms of PIs and QIs, we calculate the Kendall's statistical measure. For this kind of data, it comes to 16, implying it's a positive trend. Now, that is not enough to communicate. We probably need to also look at how significant is that trend. So therefore, we now calculate Kendall's tau using this equation, and we compare to find what is the p-value. It's a two-tailed p-value. And at a decided confidence interval, we decide whether the trend is significant or not significant. And obviously, these numbers tell us that, sure, there's a long-term trend which shows positive, but it is not statistically significant. Now, if you start applying, imagine this is just an example for the cities or across the district or state or at the even national level. For each of the air quality monitoring station, now we can prepare a trend map. And what is that trend map? The trend map here is that we are making use of the calculations done for the trend, its direction, and its significance. So you have for every station now a circle, and the circle is filled when it is significant, and the direction is telling you which direction the trend is. I have not seen such maps prepared in the country. This is a great way if I want to communicate, and imagine that instead of an air pollutant, I had used an air quality index as a surrogate. Then I could say, oh, this is the situation over the last 5 years in the city of Delhi or Mumbai, the trends in air quality, both reporting the direction and the significance. This is important part of how we use data science in data communication. Now, I can find out therefore, where do I have to work more, where the stations are showing that I need to do some intervention, or where I have progressed or not progressed. The second element is not just to look at the trends, but to look at short-term changes. And one of the very simple tools which we use for detecting short-term changes is use a box whisker plot. Very basic, very simple, but has a good visual representation even for communication. And for example, if we were to consider if the medians differ by 20%, then the change is significant. So here is a diagram, the box whisker diagram, where you see we can show the outliers, we can show all the quartiles, we can show the median. And that gives me a good understanding about the data spread. If I use that box whisker to see what was the situation in 2017 and 2018, and see the shifts happening in the median, then I can say that there could be a case of a minor change or negligible change, or a case of a major change. Again, a simple visualization to communicate short-term changes. Now, if I come back to my example again, we could look at the stations now which were placed at heavy traffic junctions. The criteria pollutant was 2.5. There was a metro construction going on which got completed in 2017. And then I want to see what's the short-term change. So here's a metro line, and I can see how the air quality had changed after the construction started or it ended, and what is the short-term change. People want to know what's the short-term change. And that's where we use very simple tools like the box whisker, but show those changes again graphically in the form of a map. So we looked at trends and we looked at changes and how do we communicate that information. But one of the major interests we have is violations over standards. So violated data points are those that lie above the defined value of the standard. Now, as we all know, the standards are specified for a pollutant and for certain averaging time. And the percent violations indicate the severity of non-compliance. But if you looked at the cases where the violation over time series for two pollutants is happening simultaneously, and if you start visualizing and estimating them, then you get much better picture to understand how the violations are happening. So these are the violations, say, for PM10, the red dots. These are the violations for NOx, and then you see this line of standard. When you put them together, then you can identify when the violations are simultaneously happening on these two pollutants. This is a very effective way to communicate, especially to the regulator, policy makers, researchers, what is it which is leading to simultaneous violations of criteria pollutants over standard. Now, since we talked about violation, I must put here a word of caution. Standards are, as we said earlier, are different for different averaging times. We have a standard for 24 hours and annual average and so on and so forth. And we generally compare the sample mean with the prescribed standard. So the mean is 100 of the data chain of our 104 values for annually monitored data. And the average or the mean is 100, and the standard, let's say, is 80. Then we say there is a violation. Now, Mike, this question to you is to be answered in the chat box. That how many of you are accounting for the standard error around the mean while declaring a valuation? So when you declare a violation, let's say you are talking about attainment and non-attainment cities, and you have all the time series of data, you're calculating averages to compare with the standard. How many of you have considered standard error, which means the standard deviation and the sample size to be brought to find the confidence interval around the mean? How many of you have done that? And how many of you are sure that our regulators, while reporting a violation, consider these standard errors? I would be very interested to know. And this is something which I know is not normally done here. So while you have a mean and you have a standard, direct comparison is not acceptable. Let's go further. Now to expand, therefore, given these challenges and to get a better descriptor of the extent of violations, you could think of creating a violation index. And I formulated it years ago, and I've been using it for assessing the hotspots. Where what I am doing is I'm looking at three attributes of the data chain. I look at the percent exceedance over the standard, with all that limitation I explained to you earlier, the magnitude or extent of that exceedance, and also very important, the percent contiguous exceedance. So the violation, if it was contiguous for 4 hours or 5 hours, it tells you the severity of the violation. So if you write an algorithm which will do such calculations to calculate percent exceedance, you may even add a caveat of simultaneous exceedance, magnitude of exceedance, and contiguous exceedance, its extent. You can estimate a violation index and compare it to stations based on the calculation of the index. So that value will certainly tell you which locations are under air quality stress and of concern. So one can write the steps and code them to process the data, time series data. This is an example for particulate matter. and you look at all these three perspectives to get a net violations index. So now when I go back to my example, I could calculate VI for all my air quality monitoring stations. And it tells me then where is the issue which I have to attend to. Now, I can make a combination of my earlier work on trend detection and short-term changes, as well as violations index. So now I have with me three variables. I know the trends, how significant, insignificant they are, upward or downward. I also know the extent of short-term change. And I also have information on the violations index. And then I can write, just like the rules we write in the expert systems, whether I am supposed to be watchful, or there is not much concern, or is this a major hotspot or a minor hotspot. If I did such a classification based on these multi-criteria, where I look at each station, look at the long-term trend, the short-term change, and the violation index, apply my expert rule, then I can come with interpretation to communicate. So I can now say that I have to be watchful here. This station, I don't have to worry much. This seems like a major hotspot, and so on. Believe me, but I haven't come across data science applied in this way to make effective communication, not just to public, but I'm saying here, for the policymakers, regulators. There's a lot one can do. I feel sorry that the data is still in the coffins, and people like you have to take over and analyze this data in a meaningful manner. These are not complicated tools at all, very basic, but then start communicating meaningfully and also question the very quality of the data. Moving on, the later part now, I will talk about the metadata, which is extremely important to understand how the air dispersion, pollutant dispersion is happening. And we are all familiar with the standard windrows, where we classify across the wind directions, the wind speeds, and the different classes. More information you get as you split the annual windrows into seasonal windrows, which is very important sometimes to decide which will be fixed and moving air quality monitoring stations. There's a lot of use of the seasonal windrows one can make. But have you heard about persistent windrows? This is my question for you in the chat box. Please answer, have you heard about persistent windrows? And this is an important windrows to use whenever you have odor complaints coming. This talks about what is the frequency that the wind was persistent, let's say over 4 hours in the whole year. And these are specialized wind roses, which are also very important when we talk about complaints. Since we are talking about that, most of you know, all of you may be using pollution roses, where we bring wind speeds and concentration together to give you another opportunity for a meaningful interpretation and communication. But more lately, you would find that there's increasing use being made for the conditional bivariate probability functions to analyze the concentration and the metadata by combining additional variable, where we have now in this conditional probability function, not just wind speed and direction, but also the concentration. And polar plot, which is a technique to visualize and process such a data, is very exciting because it helps us to understand for different mean values of the concentration, what is the conditional probability function, and that gives you a good opportunity for source diagnosis. So this is an example from one of the published papers where there were a number of emission sources at different distances from the city center, and concentrations were measured of pollutants. And here the CPFs are generated for NOx for different mean percentiles And for SOCs, and you have another distribution depending on, of course, the emission influence. And you can here identify who could be most probable emissions influencing that monitoring station. So here you know that for that CPF is giving you a diagnosis, the emission influence coming from coke ovens, dracs, and so on and so forth. So there are very interesting visualizations for interpretations available with us where we could either supplement or even do away from a very expensive sources of perceptor or source apportionment diagnostic. This is again something very, very interesting tool that one can use for visualization and communication. So this is for identifying sources, again at different CPF values, giving more and more insight. To end now, I didn't touch much upon air quality index is because, of course, fundamentally, any aggregation function, whichever form you do, and any normalization exercise you do, like concentration divided by a standard, and then you may or may not have weights, it makes the situation very subjective. And the index by itself suffers from problems of both non-uniqueness and ambiguity. So I can reach an air quality index, even if I aggregate it cleverly, I may have a difficulty in interpretation. If I use a maximum value function, then it's not possible for me also to capture pollutant interactions. So that's a challenge because particulates are not innocent. They're laden by the byproducts of reactions. So you may have to look at not just the particulates and the gases, or even the earlier days we were looking at product of concentrations of particulates and the gas concentrations. This is one of the challenge. How do you bring in pollutant interactions? And the index doesn't, most cases, very few I have seen attempt to include the MET variables. So this is a challenge which will remain to be a challenge. In terms of communicating air quality generally to the public. If you come back and look at what Professor Shiva started, talked about NCAP, you see the increase which we expect to see in the next couple of years in manual stations, automatic stations, not just in urban areas, but also in rural areas. And this given expansion, we are going to require an extensive capacity for data analysis and interpretation and communication. We'll also have to find ways how could we use this data intelligently for hotspot-based forecasting. I think some of these slides which I shown you earlier using trend maps or violation index or bringing both together are useful, you know, to really come up with hotspots. And that's where you come to the point of effective communication to stakeholders, not just public, communication also to policymakers and regulators, politicians as well. So we have challenges. Data is, I said, already voluminous, unstructured, a lot of which is questionable and missing and repeating. If you have a lot of efforts needed for data cleaning, then you go ahead with analytics for interpretation, reporting, and communication. And you may utilize simple tools or more complex tools. We still are underutilizing the metadata which we collect. We need to improve on our violation analysis as well as, you know, encourage more and more quantitative trending. Source apportionment, source influence using the data itself is a very attractive proposition, and therefore we need lots of training activities and tools to be developed, obviously, that we bring the cadre, we build that cadre. Those who can analyze and those who can also question the regulator for not analyzing, interpreting, and communicating the data what it deserves. So that's why I enjoy working with real data. And I also enjoy bringing in along with me people who are practicing and they are in the field. Any one of you ever interested, most welcome to come to my office. if there are many coming at a time, we'll do such jam sessions together where we actually start playing with the data and innovate. Thank you very much for listening. I've not looked into the chat box, but I hope I see something interesting there. Back to you, Professor.
Professor Madhak, thank you very much for the very interesting and innovative way of presenting so many aspects of air quality data. There are some questions in the chat box. And before that, I thought we will quickly take one picture of all who have participated in this lecture, and then we will go answering the questions. And by the time their mind also start thinking about some more questions, which they can ask you. Could you all please start your video for a minute, and then we will have one photo with Professor Madhak. So once ready, you please inform to Professor Madhak so that he will be.
Oh, I see some of my very old students here.
Yes. Yeah.
I'm happy that they tolerated me for this long.
Okay. So could you, Gopika, could you see everybody is on? So please take the photograph. I mean, snapshot.
Yes, sir. The photographs have been taken.
Yeah. You have taken? It has been taken, Dheeraj?
Sir, it has been taken.
Okay. Professor Madhak, there are many questions in the chat box, and probably one of the question was raised was sometime the data quality is a major concern. So for example, many monitoring stations, if the student collect the data and they notice that they finally end up with getting only 10 or 20% of the data, how do we address this? What's your advice on this issue?
Very simple. Make the pollution control board aware that the data is completely crap, and they have to fix it right on the field. Immediately. There are two things. Site audits are not done. Very rarely done. And I haven't seen national level site audits carried out by independent agencies. That's one of the major issues. And then, of course, the problem of the instrumentation. Many of these instruments are not tropicalized. There are power issues, which is a real problem. I think it's important that any researcher, when they find that the data chains are not so good, should write to the regulator, make the regulator aware. And I'm sure if the regulator is made aware, they will take action.
Another question related to that. So one of the researchers has asked, this is a quite common, I also noticed this, that when you sum up this NO and NO2, it should be equal to NOx, but sometimes it is not, it always less. Generally the students will always find it, how do we interpret this kind of data? So what's your advice on that?
You will rarely find that matching, that addition. Because if you go to the root of the basis of the analysis and the stoichiometric factors used for conversion, they have been over years also empirical, in some cases theoretical. So you will find there is not exact match between these two. You have to live with it.
Okay. So Professor Madhak, you asked the persistence windrows diagram. I just noticed that there are few students, many of them said no and a few of them said yes. And just for the benefit of those who have not understood, could you
explain? So we analyze the standard wind rows, and then we figure out how many times the wind was blowing in the same direction. Suppose I can create a persistent wind rows for say 3 hours. So it will calculate the frequency of the wind in each direction where the direction did not change for 3 hours and show that percentage. So this becomes very useful when there is an odor complaint. And you may even find then that the persistent windrows is actually confirming that the direction from the industry, let's say as example, was steady for several hours towards the receptor. It's a good practice to do a persistent windrows as well. Useful also for source diagnosis.
So there's one question. How do we try to find repeated values? Do we need to consider 1 hour average value? Now these days the LOCA sensors are coming, every 1 minute also values are coming, or 8 hour average values. So how, what's your advice on?
So there is no specific averaging time. Just in a data chain, you have to find out how many and how long are the values repeating.
Okay.
For example, I was analyzing one of the state pollution control board's data, and I found that the values were repeating, same value, sometimes over even days, but they were not noticed. So this is a very, very common thing. Values are repeating.
So there's a question on comparing data. So how do we compare the fixed air quality monitoring data with personal air quality monitored data? That's what the LOCA sensors without calibration, is it acceptable? I mean, there are a lot of discussion, and based on your, you know, you have a wider experience, vast experience.
My answer is, don't just compare.
Okay.
Just don't take that trouble to compare. It's like if you're working, shall I say, like a detective to solve a crime, you will look at some 10, 15 different items to make your inference. And that inference has no equation or comparison. So you look at data given by LOCA sensors, data coming from manual fix stations or continuous other analyzers, see the context where it was sampling done and collected. But the idea is to get an aggregate picture and not to make comparison.
Okay.
That is how I will put it.
So there's one question on related to the long-term trend analysis. How long should be the data in order to look at long-term trend analysis, particularly in the context of to see some of the policy changes, to look at it whether their implementation have been helpful in understanding, in reducing the pollutant concentration?
I would say at least minimum 3 years, and go on beyond three, up to even 10 years. For example, the switch to CNG in Delhi can be better understood over 10 years long-term trend analysis.
So there's one question related to how we can analyze the relation between air pollutants and MET data. I think you already answered it, maybe just for the wind rows and pollution rows diagram is somewhere. Yeah,
but I think all of you students particularly start interpreting polar plots. And you should do that where there is already field-based work done on source apportionment and try to compare the results.
So this is something interesting. So how we can analyze or interpret only with the PM data, whether vehicular emission is contributing in a particular area. Is it possible?
Yeah. You can look at elevated sources of PM, ground level sources of PM, and you set around the mean the conditional probability function such that it starts revealing.
Mm-hmm.
So, as you know, to do polar plots, you have ready-made tools available in libraries like R. So there's no sweat, and you can generate these polar maps. And I think the more important part, apart from the tool, is the skill, how to set the mean values of the CPF so that you can interpret the sources. So this is like histopathology.
Yeah. I think there was a question from I think Professor Margaret Bell. I mean, she's also working extensively on this traffic related data, and she also developed many analytical methods to address various issues. Okay, so I think she will go into the local authorities. Okay, this the question is how in the present context, sir, in all the developed countries, there may be because they use some of the analytical methods in interpreting the data and try to make use of it in day-to-day decision making, but it is still need lot of thinking and work in our country. So what's your comment on that one, sir?
I didn't get that. I thought it's a comment or a question.
Yeah, I mean, she has put a comment, but I was just trying to look at it. How do we look at it, a data analysis part, to be part of the decision making in our country?
You know, I will tell you. All you professors should leave your university office, go and sit in Tamil Nadu Pollution Control Board's office, sit there, and spend time with the field officers and environmental engineers, and teach them right there and there. There is a gap between the university professors and researchers and people in the field.
Okay.
I'll tell you something.
Yes, sir.
I told the chairman of Rajasthan Pollution Control Board to send 5 officers and live with me for 1 week in my office and bring Jaipur data. And they worked. And I could excite them that when they went back, they continued using these techniques. If each one of us here from academia pledge that you will influence 5 people from the regulator, we're done with it. Otherwise, we'll just keep talking that there's a problem. Please leave your beautiful IIT Madras campus. Don't go to teachers. Go straight to the Tamil board. I will say the same thing to Mukesh Sharma and Mukesh Kare. Let's do it or get them to your campus. Unless we do that and talk in a simple language and excite them that how now they are opening, I would call it the jewelry box of the data. See the jewel inside. People don't understand there's rich there. So this is the thing. We have to make efforts. And I think I know all of you are committed, except what I want is I should know one day that Professor Kare Musharma ji and Shiva is not available 1 week. Idhar gaye. So they are sitting in the pollution control board. We have to do that. That's the thing.
So I already see the message from Professor Mukesh Sharma that he's contributing to the time to assist any of the national
teams. I know Mukesh does it. I want him to do more. They're all great professors. But this is my general comment. I just gave names as an example.
So, sir, one of the things I completely agree with you.
My idea was to just tell that academia has to not just keep critiquing on the data, but go and solve the problem.
Sir, there is one question related. Does PM2.5 and PM10 ratio can be considered as an indicator for vehicular emissions?
Yes, it's a signature. And you can look at that as a signature. But I use it mainly to see abnormal behavior in the data or questionable data. But I have found the ratios to be signatures in different cities also. I mean, I looked at Maharashtra PM2.5, PM10, and Rajasthan. The background particulates in Rajasthan have a definitive role to play in changing the signature.
Okay. Yeah. Sir, and one more thing. So I just wanted to understand this because now at least this National Clean Air Mission is at least trying to bring more academics and also regulatory and also the urban local bodies together. Probably that is something which will going to help in reaching out the what you have indicated. I think the other question which is still revolving in my mind is how to look at it, because the areas have been spread For example, city like Chennai, city like Bombay or Delhi, Bangalore, the areas are widespread. And the measurements, what we are making it is all location specific. And most of our actions related to the management are city level. So how do we connect them? Because I just look at it, there is a lot of disconnect between what we are trying to address it. Since it is if it is a location specific, should we look for a location specific air quality management?
Yeah, it's a good point. I mean, that gives me to tell you two types of responses. First, of course, that we are limiting to one fixed location. And we're investing a lot. And if I looked at from the point of view of return on that investment, I hardly make use of that data. That's a pity, isn't it? That you spend a crore rupees on that station and you know there is no decision making based on that data. Now, if you go back to 30, 40 years, when the whole idea came of participatory air quality monitoring, even using dust jars, that happened a lot in China, that most residents in China interested in air quality started putting in their balconies a dust jar. I did such a kind of an experiment in Mumbai in 1990. And we collected 500 data points. People traveled from different parts of Mumbai, came to Shivaji Park, collected the dust jars, kept in their house for 2 weeks. We weighed after 2 weeks. We plotted them on Bombay. Discussions started, oh, why am I getting high? Why is the other person getting low? Oh, somebody said there's a building construction going on. The point I'm making, Shiva, here, that we have to go beyond to the purpose why we are doing monitoring. Suppose I tell you the value has crossed the standard. Is it a good way that I'm communicating to the people who doesn't even know what's microgram per cubic meter? What I found in Bombay when I did in 1990, there was a commotion because they understood dust fall. Now, this is not science for today's understanding of impact of particulates on health. But my objective was achieved in making people angry and question the regulator. So please look at, therefore, air quality monitoring, not as something where we can publish papers, but something which we can bring action, yeah. Awareness and action. So we may use different tools. We may even go back to sulfation candles. I was giving example. Sulfur dioxide is no more an issue today in our cities. But you know, low cost effects monitoring, supplemented by high frequency, high quality, fixed station monitoring. We'll have to use a whole mosaic of information. Whole mosaic. When you bring me, suppose, such a mosaic of information, I will need a much deeper understanding to interpret that data. And let us develop a project for a city where you have a mosaic of data sources from low-cost sensors, effect monitoring, high frequency or continuous analyzers. You have remote sense interpretation on the atmospheric optical depths. And that entire khichdi of data when I get, how do I cook it? How do I interpret it? Today, that is the biggest challenge of science in air quality. I look at loss of chlorophyll early days, 30 years ago, remember in Delhi, they were near India Gate, we put plants, we looked at discoloration, loss of chlorophyll, and people looked at it to understand what's happening. I remember we had in Bombay, in KEM Hospital, Professor Kamath, who pioneered health impacts of air because of air pollution. You know, I got to the public lungs of people who died in formalin to see how gray they were choked with particles. That did wonders. Communication has to be innovative. For example, in the city of Pune, I had data on air quality, but I also had data from the chemists on the sale of Astellin, the inhaler.
Mm-hmm.
We plotted that together. Mm-hmm. And that made a lot of sense to understand what people should know about air pollution.
Okay.
So can we not be more innovative? Can we not think out of the box? Can we not cross our boundaries so that we interact with others in the interest that we want to protect their quality? Our interest is not measurements only. That is a problem.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. And maybe, sir, you have touched upon so many aspects of data analytics, including the conditional probability plots, which is coming up now. Using as one of the tool to identify sources. So what do you think, sir? Because now more and more, sensors are being used. Artificial intelligence is something, machine learning, artificial intelligence is, these are the, buzzwords now these days, to promote any air quality researcher, if you ask, they will all more fascinated to do this kind of research now. So what's your advice on that one? So because...
First advice, these people who are working on such kind of data analytics.
Yes, how do we look at it? How do we, yes.
Go to the field and monitor, get participate to understand how data is collected. I nowadays find students who have no connection to the reality, but they know algorithms. That's not done. First, go to the field, get maturity. Then come to analytics.
Okay, yeah, that is a, it's a good once if they understand experience, and probably they may provide better solution to the society. So I think thank you very much, sir. I think we had a
pleasure and always
pleasure in listening to you. So on behalf of Air Quality Management Research Group at IIT Madras and across the country, we thank you all for the, your time for this wonderful lecture. I take this opportunity to, I'll request Dr. Madhusudan to summarize. Dr. Madhusudan, over to you.
Yeah. So I think in this afternoon was enriched with this presence and great advice for the young researchers, and also the great advice for the professors who have listened this lecture series. Today we have the 9th lecture series. It was delivered by Dr. Prasad Modak. He discussed about analyzing ambient air quality data, better decision making and communication. Sir has started the lecture with importance of air quality monitoring, the importance of public involvement, and connecting why the monitoring is required for any city. He explained about the manual to satellite imaginaries data, outdoor to indoors, high volume samplers to sensors, data analysis and communications. And further, he has explained the issues related to data preparation, missing of the data, outliers, and how to compute such outliers by using the experimental models like Mann-Kendall's test and Box-Whiskers plots to interpret the data and better visualization of the data which is already collected. Further, he was discussing about the violation index and also how the windrows, persistent windrows, pollution rows, and polar plots to be analyzed and interpreted by any air pollution researcher. Concluded this lecture series with the importance of communication behind air quality index and also the National Clean Air Program, how it communicate to the larger masses. Rather than his lecture, I think we we are grateful to you to listen your question answer session. That was quite comprehensive, and also the researchers definitely will be understanding the importance of looking into the data and interpreting the data in different ways. Being worked in regulatory for more than 30 years, I definitely feel that the importance of data interpretation and how data to be useful for the researchers to interpret it. And being part of this data analysis and the data interpretation, I definitely feel that when we wanted to clear the bills of the data producer or data this one, what basically we go with the thumb rules. What is the missing data and how the missing data to be interpreted, or how the amount has to be cut. So these are some of the tools we look into it, rather than we look into the quality of the data or the data frequency we are receiving. So I definitely feel that the lecture by Professor Modak has enlightened many of our research students to work more into the air quality research field. On behalf of the SIPA network and IITM, we thank Professor for giving the excellent lecture. And also we thank all the senior professors, the colleagues from different state pollution control boards, central pollution control boards, and also from different industries and researchers and students who have patiently listened to his lecture. Thank you once again for thank you once again. I thank all the participants who have attended this today's ninth lecture series of IITM and SIPA network. Thank you once again, sir. Thank you.
Thank you,
Professor Modak. We look forward to many more insightfulness in addressing this air quality in many cities.
Thank you.
Okay, for other participants, I would like to say Professor Modak has an interesting blog. I happen to read his blog. It is very, and probably I'm going to share with all the all of you. So it's quite interesting to follow his blog. It's inspiring. Read. Happy to read. Thank you, Professor Modak.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Yeah, bye, sir.